The Kingdom of the Greedy Part 2. In those days powdered sugar had not been invented, and to grate it all was no small affair. It was the work that the grocers used to dislike the most, both lungs and arms were soon tired. But Mother Mitchell was there to sustain them with her unequaled energy. She chose the laborers from the most robust of the boys. With mallet and knife she broke the cones into round pieces, and they grated them till they were too small to hold. The bits were put into baskets to be pounded. One would never have expected to find all the 1,000 pounds of sugar again. But a new miracle was wrought by Mother Mitchell. It was all there. It was then the turn of the ambitious scullions to enter the lists and break the 7,000 eggs for Mother Mitchell. It was not hard to break them, any fool could do that, but to separate adroitly the yolks and the whites demands some talent, and, above all, great care. We dare not say that there were no accidents here, no eggs too well scrambled, no baskets upset. But the experience of Mother Mitchell had counted upon such things, and it may truly be said that there were never so many eggs broken at once, or ever could be again. To make an omelette of them would have taken a saucepan as large as a skating pond, and the fattest cook that ever lived could not hold the handle of such a saucepan. But this was not all. Now that the yolks and whites were once divided, they must each be beaten separately in wooden bowls, to give them the necessary lightness. The egg beaters were marshaled into 2 brigades, the yellow and the white. Everyone preferred the white, for it was much more amusing to make those snowy masses that rose up so high than to beat the yolks, which knew no better than to mix together like so much sauce. Mother Mitchell, with her usual wisdom, had avoided this difficulty by casting lots. Thus, those who were not on the white side had no reason to complain of oppression. And truly, when all was done, the whites and the yellows were equally tired. All had cramps in their hands. Now began the real labor of Mother Mitchell. Till now she had been the commander-in-chief, the head only, now she put her own finger in the pie. First, she had to make sweetmeats and jam out of all the immense quantity of fruit she had stored. For this, as she could only do one kind at a time, she had 10 kettles, each as big as a dinner table. During 48 hours the cooking went on, a dozen scullions blew the fire and put on the fuel. Mother Mitchell, with a spoon that 4 modern cooks could hardly lift, never ceased stirring and trying the boiling fruit. 3 expert tasters, chosen from the most dainty, had orders to report progress every half hour. It is unnecessary to state that all the sweetmeats were perfectly successful, or that they were of exquisite consistency, color, and perfume. With Mother Mitchell there was no such word as fail. When each kind of sweetmeat was finished, she skimmed it, and put it away to cool in enormous bowls before potting. She did not use for this the usual little glass or earthen jars, but great stone ones, like those in the 40 Thieves. Not only did these take less time to fill, but they were safe from the children. The scum and the scrapings were something, to be sure. But there was little Toto, who thought this was not enough. He would have jumped into one of the bowls if they had not held him. Mother Mitchell, who thought of everything, had ordered 200 great kneading troughs, wishing that all the utensils of this great work should be perfectly new. These 200 troughs, like her other materials, were all delivered punctually and in good order. The pastry cooks rolled up their sleeves and began to knead the dough with cries of, "Hi! Hi!" that could be heard for miles. It was odd to see this army of bakers in serried ranks, all making the same gestures at once, like well-disciplined soldiers, stooping and rising together in time, so that a foreign ambassador wrote to his court that he wished his people could load and fire as well as these could knead. Such praise a people never forgets. When each troughful of paste was approved it was molded with care into the form of bricks, and with the aid of the engineer-in-chief, a young genius who had gained the first prize in the School of Architecture, the majestic edifice was begun. Mother Mitchell herself drew the plan. In following her directions, the young engineer showed himself modest beyond all praise. He had the good sense to understand that the architecture of tarts and pies had rules of its own. And that therefore the experience of Mother Mitchell was worth all the scientific theories in the world. The inside of the monument was divided into as many compartments as there were kinds of fruits. The walls were no less than 4 feet thick. When they were finished, 24 ladders were set up, and 24 experienced cooks ascended them. These first-class artists were each of them armed with an enormous cooking spoon. Behind them, on the lower rounds of the ladders, followed the kitchen boys, carrying on their heads pots and pans filled to the brim with jam and sweetmeats, each sort ready to be poured into its destined compartment. This colossal labor was accomplished in one day, and with wonderful exactness. When the sweetmeats were used to the last drop, when the great spoons had done all their work, the 24 cooks descended to earth. Again, the intrepid Mother Mitchell, who had never quitted the spot, now ascended, followed by the noble Fanfreluche, and dipped her finger into each of the compartments, to assure herself that everything was right. This part of her duty was not disagreeable, and many of the scullions would have liked to perform it. But they might have lingered too long over the enchanting task. As for Mother Mitchell, she had been too well used to sweets to be excited now. She only wished to do her duty and to ensure success. All went on well. Mother Mitchell had given her approbation. Nothing was needed now but to crown the sublime and delicious edifice by placing upon it the crust, that is, the roof, or dome. This delicate operation was confided to the engineer-in-chief, who now showed his superior genius. The dome, made beforehand of a single piece, was raised in the air by means of 12 balloons, whose force of ascension had been carefully calculated. First it was directed, by ropes, exactly over the top of the tart, then at the word of command it gently descended upon the right spot. It was not a quarter of an inch out of place. This was a great triumph for Mother Mitchell and her able assistant. But all was not over. How should this colossal tart be cooked? That was the question that agitated all the people of the greedy country, who came in crowds, lords and commons, to gaze at the wonderful spectacle. Some of the envious or ill-tempered declared it would be impossible to cook the edifice which Mother Mitchell had built, and the doctors were, no one knows why, the saddest of all. Mother Mitchell, smiling at the general bewilderment, mounted the summit of the tart. She waved her crutch in the air, and while her cat meowed in his sweetest voice, suddenly there issued from the woods a vast number of masons, drawing wagons of well-baked bricks, which they had prepared in secret. This sight silenced the ill-wishers, and filled the hearts of the greedy with hope. In 2 days an enormous furnace was built around and above the colossal tart, which found itself shut up in an immense earthen pot. 30 huge mouths, which were connected with thousands of winding pipes for conducting heat all over the building, were soon choked with fuel, by the help of 200 charcoal burners, who, obeying a private signal, came forth in long array from the forest, each carrying his sack of coal. Behind them stood Mother Mitchell with a box of matches, ready to fire each oven as it was filled. Of course the kindlings had not been forgotten, and was all soon in a blaze. When the fire was lighted in the 30 ovens, when they saw the clouds of smoke rolling above the dome, that announced that the cooking had begun, the joy of the people was boundless. Poets improvised odes, and musicians sung verses without end, in honor of the superb prince who had been inspired to feed his people in so dainty a manner, when other rulers could not give them enough even of dry bread. The names of Mother Mitchell and of the illustrious engineer were not forgotten in this great glorification. Next to His Majesty, they were certainly the first of mankind, and their names were worthy of going down with his to the remotest posterity. All the envious ones were thunderstruck. They tried to console themselves by saying that the work was not yet finished, and that an accident might happen at the last moment. But they did not really believe a word of this. Notwithstanding all their efforts to look cheerful, it had to be acknowledged that the cooking was possible. Their last resource was to declare the tart a bad one, but that would be biting off their own noses. As for declining to eat it, envy could never go so far as that in the country of the greedy. After 2 days, the unerring nose of Mother Mitchell discovered that the tart was cooked to perfection. The whole country was perfumed with its delicious aroma. Nothing more remained but to take down the furnaces. Mother Mitchell made her official announcement to His Majesty, who was delighted, and complimented her upon her punctuality. 1 day was still wanting to complete the month. During this time the people gave their eager help to the engineer in the demolition, wishing to have a hand in the great national work and to hasten the blessed moment. In the twinkling of an eye the thing was done. The bricks were taken down one by one, counted carefully, and carried into the forest again, to serve for another occasion. The tart, unveiled, appeared at last in all its majesty and splendor. The dome was gilded, and reflected the rays of the sun in the most dazzling manner. The wildest excitement and rapture ran through the land of the greedy. Each one sniffed with open nostrils the appetizing perfume. Their mouths watered, their eyes filled with tears, they embraced, pressed each other's hands, and indulged in touching pantomimes. Then the people of town and country, united by one rapturous feeling, joined hands, and danced in a ring around the grand confection. No one dared to touch the tart before the arrival of His Majesty. Meanwhile, something must be done to allay the universal impatience, and they resolved to show Mother Mitchell the gratitude with which all hearts were filled. She was crowned with the laurel of conquerors, which is also the laurel of sauce, thus serving a double purpose. Then they placed her, with her crutch and her cat, upon a sort of throne, and carried her all round her vast work. Before her marched all the musicians of the town, dancing, drumming, fifing, and tooting upon all instruments, while behind her pressed an enthusiastic crowd, who rent the air with their plaudits and filled it with a shower of caps. Her fame was complete, and a noble pride shone on her countenance.